We are discussing major domains of the earth. So, as we have already seen, that the earth is the only planet which has life. So, human beings can live here, and because the life sustaining elements like the land, water, and air are present in the earth, on the earth. Now, not only human beings, but if flora and fauna is the animals, the plants also, they have the life sustaining elements of land, water, and air. Now, the surface of the earth is a complex zone in which three main components of the environment meet. They overlap and they interact. The solid portion of the earth on which we live, we walk, is called the lithosphere. The gaseous layer that surrounds the earth is the atmosphere, where the oxygen, nitrogen, carbon dioxide, and various other gases are found. Water covers a very big area of the earth surface, nearly two-thirds or 75% of this area, and this is called as hydrosphere. Now, the hydrosphere comprises water in all of its form, that is the ice, the water vapor. The biosphere is that narrow zone where we find land, water, and air together, which contains all forms of life. So we are talking about the place or zone where all these are together. This is biosphere. Now let us talk about the origin of this word. How this have come up? Who coined this word? So in the Greek language, lithos means stone. That is why the solid portion of the earth where we live is lithosphere. Atmos means vapor. So all the gases, therefore atmosphere. And hudor. Hudor means water. That is why we have hydrosphere. Bios, because of all these three, bios, actually it meant life in Greek. Therefore, we have biosphere. So let us know about them separately. Lithosphere. So the solid portion of the earth is called lithosphere, and it comprises the rock of the earth crust and the thin layer of soil that contains nutrient element which sustain organisms and of course plants. And there are two main divisions of the earth's surface. The large land masses, these are known as continents, and the huge water bodies are called the ocean basins. So all the oceans of the world, they're connected with one another. We'll see on the map, and you just have to see that are all the land masses also connected with one another. The level of seawater remains the same everywhere, and elevation, that is the height of the land, is measured from the level of the sea. And level of the sea, sometimes we call it as mean sea level or sea level, is taken as zero. So this is what we are talking about. See, this is the map of the world. So it shows the continents and ocean. So this is North America, South America, Africa, Europe, Asia, and Australia. And as we talked about the connectivity, see, these are different because they are somewhere they are connected, somewhere they are not. Like if you talk about Australia, now Australia is not connected, but it's a country. And here, North America, this is somewhere not connected with the South America, but we can say that not, they are not really very connected, but in terms of the transportation, in terms of all the flights and ships we have, they are actually connected, but physically they might not. But Europe, there is a difference of this mountains, so they are called as separate continents. When we talk about the oceans, we have Pacific here, Pacific Ocean, Atlantic Ocean, Indian Ocean, Arctic Ocean, this is Southern Ocean. And if you see, these oceans are somewhat connected. When we have Antarctica also, that is on the pole. So the highest mountain peak, Mount Everest, this is the highest mountain peak, is 8848 meters, that is around 9 kilometers above the sea level. So the greatest depth of 11,022 meter is recorded at Mariana Trench in the Pacific Ocean. So this is the depth, you can understand, it's around 11 kilometer in the Pacific Ocean. Now, can you imagine the depth of the sea is much more than the highest point? See, this is around 11 kilometer, and this is less than that, that is 9 kilometer. So around 2 kilometer difference is there of highest peak and highest depth. Before we go ahead, Edmund Hillary of New Zealand and Tenzing Norgay Sherpa of India were the first men to climb the highest mountain peak, Mount Everest, on the planet Earth on 29th May 1953. Edmund Hillary and Tenzing Sherpa. Junko Tabe of Japan was the first woman to reach the summit on 16th May 1975. So she was the first woman. These were two men who reached there. This is called a summit. So the first Indian woman to climb the highest peak on 23rd May 1984 was Bhajendri Pal. Bhajendri Pal was the first Indian woman. Now, talking about continents, there are seven major continents, seven, and they are separated by large water bodies. That is why we said they are not that much connected. But today we can't say they are not connected because of the transportation, etc. So physically they might not be connected. And these continents are Asia, Europe, Africa, North America, South America, Australia, and Antarctica. You see that the greater part of the land mass lies in the northern hemisphere. If you see, let me take you back. This is the hemisphere or equator, 0 degree. And most of the land mass lie on the northern hemisphere. Here we have somewhat less land mass. So Asia, this is the largest continent. It covers about 1/3 of the total land area of the Earth, largest continent. The continent lies in the eastern hemisphere. The Tropic of Cancer passes through this continent. Asia is separated from Europe by the Ural Mountains on the west. The combined landmass of Europe and Asia is called the Eurasia. It is Europe plus Asia. When we come to Europe, this is much smaller than Asia, and the continent lies to the west of Asia, and the Arctic Circle passes through it, and it is bound by water bodies on three sides, because one side it is having these Ural Mountains. Africa, this is the second largest continent after Asia. The equator, or 0 degree latitude, runs almost through the middle of the continent. The large part of the Africa lies in the northern hemisphere. You will notice that it is the only continent through which the Tropic of Cancer, the equator, and the Tropic of Capricorn, all these three passes. The Sahara Desert, the world's largest hot desert, is located in Africa, and the continent is bound on all sides by oceans and sea. You will see that the world's longest river, the Nile, it flows through Africa. We have to notice where the equator, the Tropic of Cancer, and Tropic of Capricorn pass in the map of this Africa. Then North America, this is the third largest continent of the world. So it is linked to South America by a very narrow strip of land called the Isthmus of Panama. So North America and South America are connected by very, very narrow strip of land, that is Isthmus of Panama, and the continent lies completely in the northern and western hemisphere. And three oceans surround this continent. We'll talk about them. Then South America. South America lies mostly in the southern hemisphere. So we'll talk about the ocean surrounding it. The Andes, world's largest mountain range, runs through its length from north to south. And South America has the world's largest river, the Amazon. Now, Australia is the smallest continent that lies entirely in the southern hemisphere. And it is surrounded on all sides by the ocean and the sea. That is why it is called as Island Continent. Antarctica. Now, completely, it is in the southern hemisphere. It's a huge continent. The South Pole lies almost at the center of this continent. So it is located in the South Polar region. It is permanently covered with thick ice sheets. So there are no permanent human settlements there. Many countries, they have research stations in the Antarctica. India also has research station, and these are named as Maitri and Dakshin Gangotri. So let me take you first to the this diagram again. If you see, let us talk about Asia and Europe first. So they are separated by Ural Mountains, and this is somewhat the Asia is the biggest continent. This is smaller. Africa we were talking about. Now see, these all three, Tropic of Cancer, Tropic of Capricorn, and also the equator passes through this giant continent after Asia. And apart from this, the Sahara Desert, the biggest desert in the world, lies here. Then the North America and South America we talked about. See, the Andes Mountain lies in South America, and the Amazon River also flows through South America. This is North America, and they are separated by, as we saw, talked about, the Isthmus of Panama. And this is Australia. Now, this Australia is actually a country, but it's a continent. It's an island continent. All it is surrounded by water. And this is the place we called Antarctica. This is also one of the continent, and see, it is shown in white because most of the area or whole of the area is covered by thick snow, and various countries have their research station here, like we called talked about Maitri of India and the other one, which was the Dakshin Gangotri. So this is the Isthmus. This is a very narrow strip of land joining two land masses, which is North America and South America. So a strait is what? This is a strait. A strait is a narrow passage of water connecting two large water bodies like sea and oceans, right? Sea and oceans name, we have to see that there are names for different things. That is, an ocean is different because it is very huge, but sea is located to a central part, which is not so big as ocean. So that is why we call it as seas and ocean. Now, hydrosphere. The Earth is called blue planet. So more than 71% of the Earth is covered with water, and 29% is with land. So you can say around two-thirds is water. Hydrosphere consists of water in all of its forms, as running water in oceans and rivers, in lakes, ice in glaciers, underground waters, and the water vapor in the atmosphere, all comprise of hydrosphere. More than 97% of earth water is found in the oceans, and they are too salty for human use. So a large proportion of the rest of the water is in the form of ice sheets or glaciers or under the ground. And a very small percentage is available as fresh water for human beings. So this is a pie chart showing exactly what we have learned. 0.03% is only fresh water. The other, this is stored in ice sheet and groundwater, around 2.8%. And 97.2% is in oceans, too salty for our use. So despite being a blue planet, we really face shortage of water. So this is the comparative size of the continents. We'll talk about that in just a bit. Let us complete the ocean first. Oceans are the major part of hydrosphere. They are all interconnected, as we just said earlier. The ocean waters are always moving. The three chief movements of ocean waters are the waves, the tides, and the ocean currents. The five major oceans are the Pacific Ocean, the Atlantic Ocean, and the Indian Ocean, the Southern Ocean, and the Arctic Ocean. These are the five major oceans. Let me go through it again. The five major oceans are Pacific Oceans, Pacific, Atlantic, Indian, Southern, and Arctic, in order of their size. So the Pacific Ocean, Pacific is the largest ocean. It is spread over one third of the Earth. The Mariana Trench, the deepest part of the Earth, lies in the Pacific Ocean, as we talked about, 11,022 meters. The Pacific Ocean is almost circular in shape. So this is the comparative size of the continent if you see block wise, and you can just count the blocks and you can understand which one is bigger and which one is smaller. This is we have to just count the square, and you can say which is the largest continent, and you can also have a comparative suggestion, which is Europe or Australia, which one is bigger. See, Europe has 9-10 blocks and it has only 8 blocks. Now, Asia and Australia, now North and South America surrounds this, right? We were talking about the oceans. So we have to look at the map and found out the location of continents around the Pacific Ocean. We were talking about Pacific Ocean, now the Atlantic Ocean. This is the second largest ocean in the world. So it is S-shaped. It is flanked by the North and South Americas on the western side and the Europe and Africa on the eastern side. So the coastline of Atlantic Ocean is highly indented. Means this irregular and indented coastline provides ideal location for natural harbors and ports. And from the point of view of commerce, it is the busiest ocean. Then the Indian Ocean. Indian Ocean is the only ocean named after a country, which is India. So the shape of ocean is almost triangular. In the north, it is bound by Asia, in the west by Africa, and east by Australia. So the Southern Ocean encircles the continent of Antarctica and extends northward to 60 degrees south latitude. So the Arctic Ocean is located within the Arctic Circle and surrounds the North Pole. And it is connected with the Pacific Ocean by a narrow stretch of shallow water. We call it as Bering Strait. So it is bound by northern coast of North America and Eurasia. This is what we called as indented coastline. Therefore, the harbors and ports, it is the busiest. The natural harbor and ports are present, and it can be, you know, they have been formulated into the various man-made ones also. Now the atmosphere. The Earth is surrounded by a layer of gas called the atmosphere, and this thin blanket of air is an integral and important aspect of the planet. It provides us with the air we breathe and also protect us from the harmful effects of sun rays. Now the atmosphere extends up to a height of about 1600 kilometers. 1600 kilometers. The atmosphere is divided into five layers. It is based on composition, temperature, and other properties. Now these layers, starting from Earth atmosphere, these are called as troposphere. See, this is the first one, troposphere. then stratosphere, then mesosphere, and then the thermosphere, and finally the exosphere. We can write, remember it as TSMTE. The atmosphere is composed mainly of nitrogen and oxygen, which makes up about 99% of the clean dry air. Nitrogen 78%, oxygen 21%. That makes up 99%. And other gases like the carbon monoxide, argon, and other comprise 1% by volume. So oxygen is the breath of life, while nitrogen helps in growing of living organisms. Carbon dioxide, CO2, though present in minute amount, is important as it absorbs the heat radiated by the earth. Radiated means once the sunlight strikes and it goes away, the carbon dioxide holds it. That is why the carbon dioxide absorbs the heat radiated by the earth, thereby keeping the planet warm. And it is also essential for the growth of plants, because plants intake carbon dioxide and they exhale the oxygen. And the density of atmosphere, see, it varies, and it varies with height. So it is maximum at the sea level, and it decreases rapidly as we go up. So you know, the climber, this, if you see, a climber experiences problem in breathing due to this decrease in the density of air. They have to carry with them oxygen cylinders to be able to breathe at high altitudes. And the temperature also decreases as we go upwards. So the atmosphere exerts pressure on the earth, atmospheric pressure. And this also varies from place to place. So some areas experience high pressure and some areas low pressure. So air moves from high pressure to low pressure, and this is called the wind. Moving air from high pressure area to low pressure zone is known as wind. Now, biosphere. Biosphere, this is the domain of life. If you see, the biosphere is the narrow zone of contact between the land. See, this is the land, this is the water, and of course, we have atmosphere air. So it is in this zone that life that is unique to this planet exists. This is, we have atmosphere, hydrosphere, and lithosphere together. That's why we call it as a biosphere. So there are several species of organisms that vary in size, from microbes and bacteria to huge mammals. And all the living organisms, they, including the humans, they are linked to each other and to the biosphere for survival. This is called the food chain. The organism in the biosphere, they may broadly be divided into plant kingdom and animal kingdom. The plant part and animal part. Plant kingdom and animal kingdom. So the three domains of the earth, they interact with each other, that is the three spheres, and affect each other in some way or the other. For example, cutting of forests or fulfilling our needs of wood or clearing land for agriculture, this may lead to fast removal of the soil from the slopes. And similarly, earth surface may be changed due to natural calamities like the earthquake. For instance, there could be submergence of land, you know, as happened in tsunami. The parts of Andaman and Nicobar Islands were submerged underwater. So discharge of waste material like into lakes and rivers makes the water unsuitable for human use, and also damages other forms of life, especially the aquatic life. So emissions from industries, thermal power plants, and vehicles, they pollute the air. Carbon dioxide is an important constituent of air, but increase in the amount of carbon dioxide will lead to increase in the global temperature, because carbon dioxide absorbs the heat radiated from the earth. And if carbon dioxide is more heat is absorbed. So this is called as global warming. So there is thus a need to limit the use of resources of the earth to maintain the balance of nature between the domains of the lithosphere, the atmosphere, and the hydrosphere, that is our biosphere.